Hello everyone, the 10th of December, 10 days into December. 16 days of activism, we're still celebrating that. But a very good morning to you. 6:30, thank you for joining us in the weekend edition. Today we promise you a show that is full of life and summer foods and desserts that you can look forward to. But before we go anywhere, I'd like to introduce all these people that you see in front of you this morning. We've got Ilse, which is our celebrity chef. Good morning. Ooh, how are you doing?
I'm good, how are you?
I'm good, thank you. It's what awesome. Are we eating today?
I'm going to show you how to make amazing desserts with summer fruits that's in season and bursting with flavor.
Wow, that's awesome. Yep. Can't wait to see that. Gürkan, welcome to the show.
Hello.
So you rode a bicycle around the world in many countries.
Yes, last 4 years I'm cycling around the world nonstop. And 2 months ago I arrived to Cape Town.
Wow. Thank you. Welcome.
Welcome.
Well, we'll be talking a lot about that. Ard, do you ride a bicycle?
I did once and all my friends were just, no, just... Rather don't.
So you're the guy that does music and entertains people rather, right?
Yeah, I write songs about love and peace and I stay off dangerous equipment, you know?
Well, I'd like to welcome you to the show.
Thank you very much, man. Good
and
to
on
be
the
here.
Other side, you're welcome. And on the other side, we have an actress and a very, very funny woman. Do you make fun of the law, Thenjiwe?
Yes, I do. The law makes fun of us.
It does. It does. Well, I'd like to welcome you to the show.
Thank
Rosie,
you.
An activist.
Yes.
And an actress.
Yes.
And now a talent scout.
Yes.
And. And that's why you're on the show with us this morning. Well, I'd like to welcome you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for joining us. Well, guys, it's going to be an amazing show, so you want to stick around. But before we go anywhere, I have Bucie standing by to give us her first performance. Good morning, and here you go.
The name of the song is All of Me. It's a love song. When you just realize how much someone loves you and you appreciate the love they have for you. Hope you enjoy it.
Never knew the kind of love existed in me.
me, yeah. And all I have to do is open my eyes in the morning, and you take it from there. And I love how you love everything about me.
There you have it. I told you that your Saturday has just gotten better. We'll help you make your December even lighter and more fun. Remember, it is hashtag the weekend edition for everything and anything that you'd like to talk about on social media. Stick around because the show's only starting and you do not want to touch that dial.
Coming up, comedian Thenjiwe Moseley tells us about how she entertains local and international audiences alike, and chef Ilse, Fourie takes us on a journey of decadent desserts.
Promised that more food and more entertainment coming your way right here on the weekend edition. We're standing in the kitchen right now with all our guests and with Ilse. So I'd like to know, what are we making now?
Well, we're gonna make a strawberry and peach galette.
That sounds like a dessert.
Yes, it's kind of like a sweet tart because we're making sweet pastry, yes, with like a nice sweet filling, and we're gonna bake it in the oven.
And what are the ingredients? Because I see we've already checked out.
It's pretty straightforward and simple. The year of the dish is the fruit. We're doing summer fruits. And as we all know, in summer fruits, if you use fruit in season, it's got the best flavor ever. So you almost don't have to do too much to it. So it's simple, straightforward, vanilla, sugar, fruit, pastry, and I'm going to show you how to do that.
You know, one thing I love about December is we don't need to worry about our weight and what we eat, and no sugar this, no dairy that. We go in. So would you say that this is the perfect dish for when you've got guests over, like on a Saturday today, near the pool, to have this served?
I think that is perfect because you can bake it, you can still eat it on the same day.
Gone in, yes.
And this is delicious.
We're almost there.
Right, well, I'm ready to see how we make this because it looks really fancy for me. Rosie, do you cook?
I do. I'm not a great baker, but I love cooking.
What type of food do you cook?
Very, very good stews, curries. I love chicken.
I'm glad that Joe isn't here because we would have had a little battle that would break out because he feels that he makes the best curry in life.
I know, I've had that battle out with him and I'm still hands down.
Oh, really?
Mm-hmm. He's still going on about that. Mm-mm.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
I'll be the judge. But do you cook as well? Lucy, do you cook?
I try.
You've got a kitchen, though.
I do. I have a kitchen, and I try, but my husband is the one that does the cooking.
You're blessed.
He's a good cook.
Oh, wow. Okay.
He's blessed.
I'm the same. My husband does the cooking.
What? Where do you find his men? Where do you find his men?
Because I'm married out of my culture, so I told him in my culture women don't cook. So.
Are you serious? What culture is this?
He's English. So I told him Zulus. We have a culture, women don't cook.
Well done.
Okay. I need to find an English guy then. I need to find an English guy. Gürkan, do you cook?
Yeah,
because you're
of course,
a guy.
Yeah.
Oh, so you're that guy that cooks.
Yeah. In my country, the most of the time, women are cooked the foods, but I am cycling around the world last 4 years, so I'm cooking my food. Wow.
So you're good?
Yeah.
Well, we'll probably put you to the test. Well, let's start and
let's
see how we make this.
Well, for those who don't like to bake, this is pretty easy. Mm-hmm. I'm not really a baker myself. I prefer food because I'm too impatient. But we're going to do this today.
Yes, we
are. Okay. Khanyi, can I give you the filling to do for me?
Sure.
Okay. So I'm going to move this over to you. So here we have sliced peach. We have some sliced strawberries. We have some vanilla extract. And then we have some sugar.
Okay.
So all you need to do, I'm going to give you a bowl. Just add everything to this bowl. And then just rub it in with your fingers, because the sugar is going to draw out the juice and it's going to get nice and sweet and lovely. And then I'm going to continue with the pastry. Okay. So we're going to mix together our flour, some sugar, because it is a sweet pastry, and a little bit of salt, a little pinch. I quite like the salt with the sweetness. It kind of balances and offsets each other. So.
Speaking of salt and sweetness, I believe that Rosie eats her strawberries with black pepper.
Mm-hmm. It makes absolute fantastic sense because it's such a good
this
pairing.
It's explosion in your mouth. It is powerful.
It's fantastic.
Can I taste that?
Is it?
But what do? You dip it in or do you mix it as I'm doing it now?
You can do it like that. It all depends on how you want to do it.
Really?
Like tequila vibes.
Can I?
It's a question.
But tequila is sweet and sour and...
Yeah, but it's got a mixture of something.
That is delicious.
Uh-huh.
Okay. And can you taste how sweet these strawberries are? Because they're in season. It's fantastic. Mm.
It's almost as if it's popping in your mouth.
Mm. But Rosie, because you've been around Africa, is this a trick that you learned through your travels?
No, I actually learned this from a friend who's from Germany.
Oh.
So I don't know if it's a German tradition, but it's been something that I've been doing for years.
But, you know, it makes perfect sense because pepper pairs really well with strawberries. Mm-hmm. And that's why you can even use basil with strawberries because it's got those peppery notes.
Oh, wow.
So in a salad, it works beautifully. Even in dessert, you can kind of wangle a bit of basil in there and it will work perfectly.
Wow. So you learned something new today.
Mm, yeah.
See, and it's good, huh?
So as you can see here, I'm grating in the butter.
Yes.
It needs to go in cold. But it's easier to, I find it's easier just to take it out of the fridge and grate it in. And then it's easier to work it into the flour with your fingers.
So oh, instead of trying to take...
That's already melted a little bit or whatever,
yes.
You know?
Does it matter how much cheese you use or just...
Cheese.
Butter.
Oh, but it looks like cheese.
I like it. She's grating it. That's why I'm
really? It looks like cheese. Oh my gosh, I just exposed
myself. So now here's the fun part about food is I love to dig in with my hands. Mm. I'm quite a messy eater as well. It's nice to just dig in with your hands. That's why I like the Indian culture with the curries and stuff so much, because you can dig in there. So now you're just going to be like working with this until you get the butter crumbed into the flour. It's getting there already. It's just kind of like rubbing it around. My mouth's already salivating because for me, sugar and butter and flour is just the best thing.
But the grating really makes it seem very easy.
So much easier, yeah. I think that people get a bit intimidated when it comes to making pastry, and it's actually so damn easy.
I get intimidated in the kitchen, period.
Well, I think after you've seen this today, you're going to be cooking this for Christmas, for dessert. You'll be like, I'll make the galette.
Wow.
Yeah. Okay, so that's in. Now you're going to be adding your ice water. It needs to be cold because we don't want the butter to melt too much. Okay, so we're adding the
ice water from the fridge.
Yeah. Just going to mix that in. And now it's getting pretty messy. And then you're going to be working this around until you get your dough. I'm not going to get too much into this. I might need a cloth.
Okay, let's try and find a cloth.
You want a paper towel?
Yeah. That could work as well. So you're going to be working this. You can see it's already starting to form a little dough. And you're not going to overwork this too much. You're basically going to wait until it's in a little ball, roll it in the ball, and then you're going to pop it into the fridge for at least an hour because you want it to be nice and cold.
But how stiff do you want it?
It doesn't even have to be that stiff because you're going to be rolling it out when it comes out of the
fridge. So it should be flexible enough for you to...
Yeah, see, this isn't like a... This isn't... Look, they're already together. Mm. You don't want to overwork it. You don't want the butter to melt too much because then your pastry isn't going to be nice.
It smells nice.
Okay, so that is my... Before fridge pastry.
Okay.
I'll be putting it in here. Then I'm going to be wiping my hands.
I'll be your sous chef.
Thank you. Okay, so this one's been in the fridge for a while. And it's pretty easy and straightforward. You've mixed in your fruit there.
And how long do we keep this in the fridge for? Because it's
about an hour. About an hour. Yeah, you need it quite firm so that you can just give it a quick roll out and pop it into your tray. Okay, so I'm going to be opening this up.
So if I had a nonstick pan, would I still need to dress it up with the...
Yes. Okay. I prefer to do that because sometimes it tends to stick and it's much easier to lift this out and just pull it off. Okay, so we're just going to be giving it a nice roll. I'm gonna grab some flour here. It was the last time we had a little bit of problems sticking.
Yes, hey? I remember.
Yeah. Okay. So it's basically about just pressing it down a bit, because it's not...
Looks like you need fitness for this, though.
I was just going to say. Mm,
you do, yeah, right?
You need fitness for that.
You look like you're fit enough to do that, so...
Let's try.
So we're going to be rolling this out pretty flat. This one's cracking a little bit.
Oh, there, it's coming together.
It's coming together. And the thing with this is, and you can make it look quite rustic. I quite like it, like when it looks rustic, yeah, and it's not too perfect.
Mm.
So, grab some flour here.
And what's the pastry supposed to taste like? For you to know that you did the right thing. Should it be a bit sour? Should it be sweet?
Definitely sweet and buttery.
Okay.
Think kind of shortcake.
Mm. Uh-huh. Yeah. Okay, my favorite. Nice.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm. That's what I'm saying. Like, I salivate when I think about it because it's butter and sugar.
Because sometimes you'd make this, then people that know it taste it and go, you missed. It's not right.
So you roll it out. I'm not going to take too much time on this because we do have the final product over there. Then you're going to take your filling, just going to scoop it in the middle.
Mm. That looks good.
It smells so good already, the fresh fruit.
So what was that? It was the fruit, sugar,
vanilla extract.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Will the pepper make it better?
What's that?
Will the pepper make it better?
We can add pepper, should we?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I wouldn't say no to
that. I actually thought earlier, you know, it would be quite a good... And vanilla and pepper, I mean, everything's going to work, and you've got that beautiful...
I know people at home are wondering, like, yo, pepper! Pepper!
So then you just kind of fold your pastry over.
On the beach, yes.
It depends.
Yes.
Mm. Yes.
And mango and spices.
Mm. Mm-hmm.
Okay, I'm not sure about the mango.
So what's also going to happen is when it bakes, it's going to just flatten out a little bit and relax a bit in the oven. Okay.
And how many people would that feed? I just need to know.
In my house, probably just two. Yeah. So. Okay, I'm going to put this on here.
It's enough for me.
It's enough for you, right?
And now you're going to egg wash it just to get that beautiful colour on top.
Uh-huh.
I'm just going to add a little bit of sugar on here before I pop it into the oven.
Okay.
And then we can.
What does the sugar do? Add taste?
It just adds a bit of caramelization on the dough.
Yes.
And a little bit of sweetness.
All right. Okay. Well, Bucie's already had hers. Is there anything else you could have it with, for instance?
It is perfect with vanilla ice cream. I was going to tell you now.
Ice cream.
Yeah.
It's space here.
Oh, please.
Here we are.
Thank you. So I'm going to give you a
scoop. We can all have a piece and...
Mm. Absolutely.
It's yummy.
Bucie?
Yes,
so what does it taste like?
Yeah, no. It tastes like a little party in your mouth.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. Like it's a party in your mouth, literally. Wow. Because you get to taste everything. You get to taste the pastry.
Yes.
With that bit of salt.
Uh-huh.
You know, just that pinch of salt. And you can taste the fruit, and it tastes even different now because it's cooked.
Of course.
You know?
Yes.
Oh, and of course the strawberries. It's just that I'm missing the... Right now, I'm just missing... I'm missing the
pepper.
Yeah. The pepper.
The pepper. But here's some ice cream.
Oh, you've got the pepper right there.
To be dollar
for have you tried it? Yes, there's a spoon.
Can I have another one?
Another spoon, sure.
You know what also works great is if you... The ice cream's a little bit melted and you drizzle it over.
Mm-hmm.
It also works really nicely.
Well, guys, for you at home, if you're wondering how we made this amazing meal, it is very simple. You need to go to Facebook, The Weekend Edition, that's our handle, and check out step by step how we got to this amazing dessert that is part of our theme. Remember, it is hashtag The Weekend Edition. I'd like to hear your thoughts. What are you getting up to this weekend? What are you eating? Who are you chilling with? What are you doing this December? We'll see you after the break. It's a weekend, yeah. Welcome back. You're still watching The Weekend Edition right here on SABC 3. So Thenjiwe is known to be a very, very funny woman. The things she says are things that you're thinking but not necessarily say them. But she's never afraid to come out and make fun of real situations and things that we do as a people. But before we talk to you,
I've already welcomed you to the show earlier on. Before we talk to you, I'd love to see some of the work that you've done so people understand who you really are. Here we go.
I'm going to be a funeral crier, so if people have funerals, they can hire me to come and cry at the funeral.
I go to Thenjiwe. We all post them on Facebook. Your words. Money tempting, but I declined the invitation. You're a professional morning.
Yes, because I need money, and I've realized that this is a service that we need in our community. Because these days, people spend a lot of money on makeup, and it's unfair for family members to be wasting their makeup crying.
So just to give you an idea what was happening in that clip, the gentleman is a producer from Zimbabwe. His name is Mr. B. He had no clue that Thenjiwe was shooting, so he thought that she really wanted to be a crier on the rail. And how did it end, though?
Well, he did believe me because there are people who do this as a profession.
True.
He was shocked, but he had no choice but to believe me because I showed him on the internet there are websites where you can actually rent a funeral crier.
So what does a funeral crier do when they get to a funeral?
They go to a funeral and they cry so that people think the deceased was very important and they had people that actually loved them.
Wow. And how much does a crier make?
A lot of money. It depends. You can...
The status of the person or the deceased.
Yes, and how much you want them to cry. There are levels of crying.
So if it's a dramatic cry that's falling down and rolling on the ground...
That's more.
It
goes up.
And, I mean, was he ready to book this crier?
Yes.
Oh, Mr. B. But a lot of criers wouldn't be happy, Thenjiwe, at the fact that you're now exposing a business that makes money for them.
But it's also promoting their business because there are people who need criers. There are people who die and nobody loves them, so nobody's going to cry at their funeral. So now they know that they can always book a funeral crier.
Were you always this funny?
I don't know. I think I was.
But growing up, were you always the funny girl in the class, the funny girl in the neighborhood, the girl that always made people laugh?
I was, but also I was the serious one because I come from a family of very funny people, funny people. And that's where I learned to be funny, I think, because we make fun of everything. Like, your mother could be dead, my grandmother will find a joke about it. Like, I come from that kind of a family, which made it easy for me because I'm from Kwamashu.
Yes.
And we didn't even realize that we were going up through violence and all that was happening at the time.
Yes.
Because we just used to make jokes out of everything.
It was a form of relief and an escape for you guys within those trying times.
Yes.
But you're a lawyer.
Was.
Was a lawyer, so you've left law to do this.
Yes.
But how? Is there money in this? Because, I mean, law has a lot of money.
Law has a lot of money, but it doesn't really have a lot of money. And there's a difference between a career and a passion. For me, comedy is a calling. If I don't do this, then why am I still alive?
Yeah.
Whereas law was like to get a serious job, to get a real job. It was not for me. And for me to do law, it was the closest thing to performing, because I would be in court, like being on stage.
Of course.
You know what's been happening.
Yes.
You have the best performers, Oscar-deserving performers in court.
Course.
So for me, it was the closest thing to being a performer. But once I found the stage and I could start doing comedy, I was like, I need to choose law or comedy. Comedy won.
But Thenjiwe, for every parent to be able to sit up and say, my daughter's a lawyer, my son's a doctor, my nephew's an architect, it's a big thing for a family to have such. When you told them that you're now leaving law to do comedy, did they take it nicely?
My grandmother still thinks I'm bewitched. And she's still praying for me every night to get a real job. And it makes it worse that I work in Johannesburg. And
yes.
She just does not understand it. You work at night in front of strangers. Most of them are men. Mm. And they just pay you for talking. She thinks I'm doing something worse than just standing up and talking at night.
At night. She thinks, it's something deeper she's covering.
And they pay you just for that? She doesn't believe me.
Now, you come from a very serious background of law, and I mean, lawyers take themselves very, very seriously, especially when they're together. I've seen them in public. How did you then find that you could do this? When was the day where you realized your talent to say, I'm actually good at this thing?
It was actually my learned friends. We were in London after a case, and we decided to go to a place and have a few drinks. And it just happened that they were having a comedy night. So they just encouraged me, just go on stage, you always make us laugh, you always come up with these funny lines. And I went on stage, and the rest is history. I did my 5 minutes, and I was like, I don't want to put this mic down. And the reception I got from people was like, this is what I should be doing.
But why are comedians so popular, especially in our industry today? Because they're taking over. I think the two people in entertainment that are making it at this point are DJs and comedians. You can't have a party, a ceremony, anything without a DJ, and vice versa. You can't have anything without a comedian. On stage, in a movie, anywhere, you need to have a comedian. Why is that?
Because laughter is the best medicine. We need to laugh, and laughter unites people. When it comes to comedy, there's no class. Everyone can laugh at the same joke. And we are going through trying times. Mm. And if we don't laugh at ourselves, and if we don't laugh at what's happening, we're just going to be depressed. So comedy is very much needed. It's the therapy that we need.
Mm.
Especially in a country like South Africa, where we've been through so much.
Yeah.
We never went through counseling.
Yeah.
It helps that comedians can go on stage and talk about these things that people are afraid to talk about, because you never know, there's a thin line between political correctness and between being racist. And so comedians are that link that can go on stage and take that risk and talk about what you've been thinking, but you are too afraid to say because you might be judged. And we take the risk.
Mm.
We do that for you.
Mm-hmm.
And because we make you laugh through the pain, it makes it easy.
So, I mean, what is your relationship with helpers? Because a lot of people feel that helpers are abused in certain instances. Helpers can be also evil at a time, because there's a clip of yours where you're like, don't mess with a maid. What is your relationship with maids?
I've seen both sides. There are helpers that are very good and they are taken advantage of, and they are also very mean helpers. I think people should be direct from the beginning. Tell your helper how much they're gonna get paid, tell them what you expect of them, and stop this thing of making it like a relationship. You are not family.
Yes.
It's a work relationship.
Yes.
You are not family, and they must know where the limit is.
Mm.
That's when you start getting helpers holding the remote control. Now you must watch what they want to watch. And they must know when they are at work, no visitors. Just like when you are at work, you don't come here to chill with your friends, you come here to work.
True.
But we have to be honest, because the problem we have in South Africa is we now have this working class, this black people who are now can afford to have helpers.
Yes.
But they don't know the limit, because their mothers were helpers.
Yes.
So they want to overcompensate and be... But it's not good.
There's
helpers need to know where... They need to know they are working.
They need to know the line. Well, let's check out a clip that you did about don't mess with the helper. You could learn something, because I want to see what it is.
Reading it, the letter for me.
Relope is in hospital. You need to come back home soon.
Oh, I'm going to see her.
How?
Some of us know that a situation holds too well. Draw the line, people. They're there to work, right? Well, Thenjiwe, I'd like you to stick around, because I'd like to speak to you more and really get to know you some more. So if you're at home, what is your relationship with your helper? Let's talk about that, because I know a lot of women are thinking, gosh, I've got the same issue. Hashtag the weekend edition. After the break, we go back to the kitchen and we eat some more. See you now.
still to come, Just Jinjer frontman Ard Matthews talks about how he has branched out with a solo project and gives The Weeknd Edition a sneak peek of his new music.
Having sold over 250,000 albums, Just Jinjer is known as the most selling rock band in the country. No one has ever beat that. So the question is, what is the secret? Because I know if you're an artist and you're trying to sell music, you're thinking just that. So am I. All right, welcome to the show.
Thank you very much.
250,000 albums.
Yeah, I don't know. I think that was a slightly old record. I know that the boys have been hard at work, all the big rock bands in the country. But, you know, either way, it at the time when it happened, it was the biggest selling debut for rock music. So it was quite a big deal. But, you know, it's still a very small amount for the rest of the world. But we're very proud of it. Yeah.
Are you still the front man of the band?
By hook or by crook, somehow, yes. Yeah, that doesn't really change. I can't move on to drums. I think people would notice, you know, if I wasn't the one in the front singing.
But what does frontman mean? That you're the Beyonce, or because you stand in the front and you sing?
I don't have a booty like Beyonce.
Yeah.
Yet. No. But, if, you know, after Ilse's dessert, you never know what might happen or how quick that may grow. But no, just, I don't know, you just have to kind of represent. You always take all the flack, you always take, you know, you get the praise and the flack in equal
everything
portions.
Everything that goes wrong, we point at you.
Yeah, no, obviously, it's always my fault. I did everything, or I did well, which is that's fine. You take it all, you know?
How did the band come together? Because there's always a backstory to how people start a career in music.
Yeah, so I was doing like a cover thing, a duo, and Brent was with Vernie and Tux at the time, called Trifunk Era. We were playing kind of in the same area, and we used to watch each other on our breaks. And I was writing original music, like Shallow Waters was already out, and Brent came to watch, and he just called me up one day and said, "Yo, you've got to join the band." And I was like, "Okay, cool. I've got a little, you know, kind of in another band, but okay, Kiff." And then joined them, and it was Trifunk Era, and there was four of us, so that got a bit weird, so we had to drop the try.
Oh my goodness.
And then we had to try and get a name, and it got even weirder. We decided on Just Jinjer. I have no idea. We obviously did not have a PR company available to
us. So Just Jinjer just fell into your lap and you ran with it?
Yeah,
kind of. It wasn't planned?
No. Well, the plan was to do original music, and then we did try and come up with a name, and believe it or not, we even put some thought into the name, and Just Jinjer is the best we could come up with. Thank goodness we can write songs and we're not into marketing.
No, but did you come up with any other names, for instance?
All we did was drop the Tri-Funk Era, and it just became Funk Era, and we kind of worked off that for a while we're doing our search for the most iconic name with a spell change to confuse everyone ever. Anyway, I'm sure you're detecting the sarcasm.
Yes, I am. I'm trying to find it as well.
The self-loathing.
But look, I've seen a lot of groups that come up today, and music has changed its face, and it's come a long way. Do you think if you guys had met today, your success would still be the same with music and the music industry changing so much and becoming so digital?
Yeah, it's very hard to predict what would have happened with that, because, you know, everything in life is a time and a place, you know?
Yes.
And I think we got together at the right stage where people were looking for something that we were doing, really. So I think in today's age, you know, the fact that anyone with a laptop or a cell phone can submit a song to radio, yes, and now that we're playing a lot of local music,
I know,
it's getting played, and I'm so proud of South Africa. People must know that, with all my faults and whatever it is, but I love this country, and the thing is that, you know, 90% of playing everything, it's really hard to separate like the proper quality. You know, and who am I to judge? I don't know. I just do what I do. But I do hear a lot of kind of generic stuff. It's very hard for people to stand out, is my point. You know, it's a bit harder to be spotted down. It's really, really saturated.
Well, when the group approached you to join them, you had said to me earlier that you hesitated. Was music a focal point of you growing up, or is it something that you stumbled across as you were young or...
No, I started really, really late. I played drums in a death metal band called... I was a skinhead Christian death metal band drummer.
Wow.
And we delivered a message of hope on a plate of rage, was kind of how we justified playing such very violent, aggressive music. And it was a lot of fun. And that was literally my last year of high school, which would be a direct correlation as to how I did in matric. But I just made it, by the way.
Yeah, I was about to say, I was going to go there. Did you make it? Because rockers don't finish school.
Yeah, so that I was a drummer, and so I went and studied drums. I didn't know that singing would be in my future. And, yes. And then I also just kind of put two and two together and saw what drums are, you know, are they making money? And looking, I was like, you know, I need to start thinking about rent and things like that.
Yes.
So a friend of mine was doing one-man band stuff, and he was singing a song. I don't know, I just literally picked up the guitar, and as simple as that, just like, kind of got into it and started being paid to do live shows and covers, and I was like, this is unbelievable.
Awesome. Yeah. You said Christian band, so you're from a Christian family?
My mom raised me up very, very strictly Christian, and so that was my upbringing. I think I probably have a slightly different viewpoint today and age, as I encourage everyone to have. But yeah, that was a foundation, and it was quite funny being called abhorrence.
But when you changed now the genre from Christian to now rock.
Yeah, it's, I mean, you know, regardless of religion, I've always been a very positive person. I'm a big believer in love. I'm a peaceful guy, contrary to my caveman Viking murderous look.
We love it. Yeah, that's what works.
I'm the biggest softie on earth. I shouldn't give this away, but like, I'll cry at the drop of a hat, especially if it's my hat. But yeah, so you know, love, and that resonates. And I'll always write about love, and I'm unashamed about that. I think it is the most vital thing on earth that we need to do. And I don't need to be writing about any pent up anger. I had a fantastic childhood. I grew up on the ocean. My mom was super mellow. I've got no anger issues. So
of course.
That's actually a bit of a problem, because now all I can do is write about love and peace.
But we're all struggling to find out what love really is. I mean, personally, I'm trying to figure out what is love. Is it a sense of comfort? Is it having a sense of belonging? What is love to you?
Sure. I mean,
it's deep.
It is deep, and I don't know how much time we have. But I mean, I've been writing about love since, you know, for as long as I started writing music. And for me, I sometimes feel like I'm writing about unicorns because I don't quite know what I'm chasing. Yeah. I have this idea of what I think love would be, but you know, I'm currently single at the moment, and I don't know.
Single.
I don't know what's going to be in my future. I'm obviously open to all of it, but I don't have an idea of love. I think love is just about being comfortable with yourself and where you're at, and with the people that are in your life, and appreciation. I think love and appreciation are two very, very contributing factors. You know.
Well, you spoke about being comfortable with yourself, and you've just started your own solo project.
Yeah.
Is it because you guys had a fight?
No.
Or because when one leaves a band, it's always like, oh no, they had a fight.
No.
Here we go. It's about money.
Usually, there was some dodgy stuff that went on internally. That's not the case. We love each other. We are brothers. We're all like only children. I don't know what. That's terrible.
I think only children.
I'm a lyricist, I'm supposed to know these things.
Yes.
We're only kids.
Yes.
Inside. And so we actually only have each other on this earth. We are family. And of course we've had one or two like weird moments like, hey, what did you mean? But we love each other, you know, so there's no reason for us to split up or anything like that. And all it is just me expressing myself in my individual capacity, and they know it very well. They're all busy doing it themselves. They have remarkable careers outside of Just Jinjer, and it's wonderful to empower yourself. And, you know, like, just expand your portfolio, kind of.
Yeah.
You know? And it's very cool for you, because I'm a bit of a control freak, so I do love to not have to ask opinions all the time.
Of course, and just do your own thing.
Just do it. Like, is this a good idea? I don't care what you say. This is what's going down on the record. So it's been a wonderful release for me. In fact, it's made me more capable of working or continuing to work with Jinjer, and we're now in our 20th year.
Wow.
20 years we've been doing this stuff.
Well, Art, thank you so much for joining us, and I do believe that you do write about love, and you are a softie. I can feel the vibes.
It is, and may I just say, I'm very proud of the way that you conduct yourself. It's super professional. So
thank you so much.
Well done. Very, very smooth, man.
Well, there you have it, South Africa. I am professional, and I handle myself well. Speaking of Just Jinjer, he's going to give us his performance now. So stick around, and let's see how soft and well he writes about love.
Hey, I'm Ard Matthews, and this is a new song about to come out in a few weeks' time called Wonder Years.
Come, make yourself a better man. You know you wanna, and I bet you can too. So now, as you can go. Rise above yourself and float away, away, away. Come, let's get lost. Let's get out of here. Let's do all the things that love inspires. Our heart's desires. Through the wonder years. Through the wonder years. Come, I wanna take you home. Let's get lost. Let's get out of here. Let's do all the things that love inspires. Let's get away. Come with me. Take me by the hand. You know you wanna. And I think you should too. Hey now. Is this as far as we should go?
In addition, I'd like to know your thoughts on the performance that you've just seen and the show in itself. See you after the break.
After the break, Turkish adventurer Gürkan Genç has been traveling around the world on his bicycle since 2012. He stopped by the Weekend Edition to talk about his interesting travels. It's a weekend, yeah.
It's a Welcome back. So if you've got car trouble and thinking of buying a new car, well, I'd like to introduce a man who's lived on a bicycle for the past, how many years has it been? Four or five?
Oh, six totally.
6 years.
Yeah.
A man who's lived on a bicycle for 6 years. Gürkan Genç, welcome to the show.
Thank you very much. How are you?
I'm good, thank you. So you did a 49,000 kilometers in total on a bicycle around the world.
Actually, this is my world tour, but before 2012, I did another tour between Turkey to Japan. It's taken 1 year, again, 12,000 kilometers. This is another tour. This is another tour, the world tour. So 2012, I started.
But this is not normal. You are aware that this is quite
different.
I'm not
only man who's cycling like this.
Yes.
And so it's after university, you know the system. You join the system, you should find a job. Then you're going to marry,
and
you need kids. Yeah,
yes.
So, and when I arrived to 30, I had a own restaurant and bar catering company. I said, I don't like this life. So
you need more meaning to your life.
I sold everything in Turkey. Then I say, okay, now I have money, and I want to go to Japan, because when I was in university, I read the Japan history.
Yes.
And I said, wow, they are amazing people. Mm. Live there. I want to understand the culture and I want to see the Dutch people. So I said, I have time now, I have money now. I go there by bicycle. But when I say to people, hey, I am going to there by bicycle, people say to me, are you crazy?
It's
impossible.
Of course.
Yeah, I say, yeah. Yeah, I'm crazy a little, I say. So no one believed me.
I wouldn't believe you either.
Yeah, and at 31 years old, when I arrived at 31 years old, I started that trip. I never passed my border before. I never did a camping before. I don't know how to speak English very well before.
Yes.
So I learned English on the way last 6 years.
But you're cycling, so how do you learn English?
You should speak English because no one knows your language on the road.
Of course.
English is a universal universal language now, so people are speak everywhere the English language. So I bought a digital book.
Yes.
And every night in the tent, I start to read the English books.
But where would you charge in the tent?
My bicycle have a dynamo on the hub, so I can charge my computer, I can charge my action cameras, all telephones, everything. So I produce my own electric.
It's a power box.
Powerful.
Yes.
So it's first year 2010, 2011. I finished in Turkey, Georgia, Azerbaijan, Turkmenistan, Uzbekistan, Tajikistan, Afghanistan, Kyrgyzstan, China, Mongolia, South Korea, and Japan.
Wow.
After Japan, I said, okay, I can do a world tour. I fly to Turkey and I organized this tour in 2011, I organized this tour. And 2012, I started.
Yes.
In Turkey, then Bulgaria, Romania, Moldova, Ukraine, Russia, Finland, Sweden, Norway, Denmark, Germany, Austria, Switzerland, Italy, Monaco, France, Belgium, Holland, Scotland, England, Spain, Morocco, Algeria, Tunis, Libya, Egypt, Israel, Palestine, Jordan, Saudi Arabia, Bahrain, Qatar, United Arab Emirates, Oman, Ethiopia, Kenya, Tanzania, Malawi, Zambia, Botswana, South Africa, also Swaziland, Lesotho, and I arrived here 49,300 kilometers and finished in 4 years.
Wow. And so, because there's different weather changes, there are different seasons.
Yeah.
Does that change your pattern?
No, I passed the Arctic Circle in February 2013, minus 57 minus 57 on the bike. And I passed the Sahara in July 2014, I saw 61 degree in the desert. So I have some Guinness records also.
Mr. Genç, but what I need to know is cycling means it's a singular sport. It's something you do on your own. That must make you a lonely man.
The God give us only one life. I have one chance in this world, and the world is very huge. I want to see the old cultures or people. I want to understand the world.
But you're alone.
I am alone.
So no family, no kids, no wife.
Of course, you can't say to your wife, hey, look, my baby, I am coming seven years later. So this is impossible. So no baby, no wife. And it's now 4 years finished on the road and four more years, because after Cape Town, I stopped Cape Town 2 months I tried to learn the Spanish language here.
You want to learn Spanish in South Africa?
In South Africa, yeah. Now I hablo español poco. So it's okay now. Because I'm going to cycling in South America 1.5 years. I think I can learn there is better because no one speaks English there in the small village.
Yes.
And I learned the language because in every country I visited the schools, elementary schools, and I showed the kids something. Hey, if you have a dream, you can do it.
Wow.
Okay.
Philanthropy, very nice.
We didn't change the world very well. There's still a lot of problem in the world. We didn't do it best.
Yes.
But maybe they can do it.
But how do you look after your health? I mean, different countries have their own diseases that you need to be careful of, like malaria and all of that. Does your body...
Two times I broke my chest. Once a time a car hit me, I broke my leg. And once a time in Saudi Arabia, a truck hit me. I passed two operations. And I'm still alive, thanks God. It's the kind of lies. You fall down and you should get up again. So, yeah, I'm writing 3,000 pages on my blog. I have a blog and I record my voice for blind people so they don't see the world, and I show them. I try to show them the world. Wow. And in not every country, some countries I hide some letters around the world. At yes. Nice points, I hide letters for my future kids. And I take the coordinates, I'm going to give them future. It's because I want to give them an aim, a target. If you have an aim, yeah, you can do lots of good things in the world. Yeah.
Another question in people's minds now is, he spends a lot of money to achieve all of this. Yeah. How does he make the money back?
I'm not doing it for a charity or donation system. I don't do this for charity. Yeah. I do it for myself. Mm. And how can I earn money? I said the web page is very important for this. I write English and Turkish. My English is not good, so my friends are helping me for translate it. And some companies are rent parts on the blog,
yes.
So they become as sponsors. But I don't say them, they are my sponsors. They are my dream partners.
Yes.
I have a dream cycling around the world, and they support me. So, and also, last 6 years I'm cycling like this. Yeah, I earn money, and I don't need money on the road. For example, between Darussalam to Lusaka, is an example, I spent $50 in one
Why?
Month.
What did you eat?
People are inviting me to their house. They, wow. Every country, people show me their hospitality everywhere, in all over the world, everywhere. Yeah, so you don't need to spend money. People are invite you to their house, you spend time with them, and you learn their culture.
Of course.
In Africa, I eat a lot of pap, sima, in the
yes.
north side.
Yes.
Yeah, so I have now a lot of friends around the world, and don't save money. What I do with this money, I support the young generation in my country, and I give these monies to the girls, the supportive for athletes, cyclists. I give them, if they have equipments, I'm going to buy them equipments. Yeah, it's because no one give me a guarantee you're going to finish this road. One
yes.
day I can die on the road.
Yes.
So it's lots of people, when they are doing touring cycling like this, they died on the road. So I try to do my best before past the other side.
Wow, I'll be honest with you, you make it seem so easy, but you also make me question, what's my purpose as a person? I mean, we're complaining about the traffic, about not finding my hairstylist on time and getting an outfit to wear, and you're doing such greatness for a lot of people and the future generations to come. And I can only thank you for joining us, but you've really made me think about myself and say, what is my purpose?
And most of the few weeks ago, a woman asked me, hey, Mr. Gürkan, I don't have money. It's impossible. I can't travel the world like you.
Yeah.
And you have the world. You know the world. Tell me something. I want to feel same things.
Yes.
Tell me something. And I said, do a baby.
Wow.
It's the same. Okay,
because
when you have a baby, you say, she is or he is my world.
Yes.
Okay, same thing. So don't, I choose a different lifestyle.
Yes.
And all the other people's lifestyle is very nice, in my opinion. So
yeah.
Don't jealous this kind of lifestyle. It's okay.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
So, South Africa, I'd like to talk to you one-on-one with me and you. Hashtag the Weekend Edition. If you had to change the world and do one little thing to make sure that you're remembered for years and years after today, what would it be? Hashtag the Weekend Edition. Let me know on social media. I'd love to know what you're thinking. See you after the break.
Coming up, we get a taste of more of Ilse Fourie's fruit-inspired desserts as she makes a delicious watermelon and lime sorbet. It's a weekend.
Welcome back. Fruit-inspired desserts. That's the theme for today. It is December, so we're trying to give you more interesting meals to serve while you chill around the pool with your mates and make your weekend even nicer. So, Ilse, what are we making now? Because I see something's frozen over there, and I love frozen foods.
It is one of my favorite fruits, watermelon.
Yes.
I mean, that is typical December holidays.
That's summer.
Isn't it? Mm. So what better than making a watermelon and lime sorbet? Mm-hmm. And then the kids can eat it and the grown-ups can add some alcohol and make some cocktails
yes.
or some shots even.
Summer.
I mean, have you ever tried, like, you put the sorbet in a shot glass with a little bit of tequila?
Mm.
And just give it...
My mom watches the show, so I'll say no. just, you know, so that mom and I are cool.
Okay, so we're going to start by making a sugar syrup.
Okay.
It is a medium sugar syrup, which means two parts water, one part sugar.
Okay.
You get a one part, which is your thicker sugar syrup, yes. which is a basic one. Okay, so we're going to add the sugar. You're going to get me some flames going here.
Sure. But what type of sugar is it? Is it caster sugar or is it just normal sugar?
Just normal sugar, yeah. Okay. Yeah. And then your water. Okay, and then we're going to get this the sugar dissolved. We're going to get that to boil. It needs to reach about 180 degrees. If you don't have a thermometer, about 5 minutes, you'll see when it starts boiling.
All right.
Yeah. Okay, so now we're going to add some lime juice to the syrup as well.
Okay.
I don't know if you want to start juicing them or get
just
some of the like helping
that.
Hands over here. And then we have our seedless watermelon. It's about 4 cups of seedless watermelon. I'm not going to put that in there so long. It's pretty simple and pretty straightforward.
I'm going to share the
let everyone help. Get a bit of arm in there. So while this is cooking, I mean, this is so straightforward. Mm-hmm. People think that you need an ice cream maker. You don't necessarily need one. If you do have an ice cream maker, once this product is finished, you'll pop it into the fridge for about 3 hours. Pop it into your ice cream maker and churn it for about 20 minutes and you'll have a beautiful sorbet. Otherwise,
what if I don't have an ice cream maker at home and I have a basic kitchen?
Well, you pop it into your loaf tin.
Yes.
And every hour or so, take it out and just scrape it through with a fork. Pop it back in. And do it about 3 or 4 times, and you'll have a beautiful sorbet.
Wow,
yeah.
Nice.
So simple as that.
And so, if I'd like to like add other fruits like mango, or because I've seen sorbets with flavour, mm-hmm. is it the same way?
Exactly the same way.
Okay.
Which is making it so simple. Yeah. I mean, and what I also love is you can even play around with different flavour combinations. Like I like to do like a think pina colada, like pineapple and coconut milk. You know, and you kind of like incorporate that into your sorbet. So there's so many things you can do. You can even add herbs to your, and here we go again with your black pepper, like basil and watermelon. If you want to add basil to it, it's beautiful.
Nice.
So, yeah. So this is starting to boil.
And it's starting to have like a clear.
Yeah, so the sugar is dissolving.
Yes.
And we're going to bring this to the boil. It needs to reach about 180 degrees, like I said.
Yes.
Just watch the sides. Generally, we can leave it now, so it's just bringing it to the boil.
Okay.
You don't want sugar crystals to form at the edges. Because if the sugar crystal forms, it's almost like a virus. It spreads throughout your sugar syrup.
Mm-hmm.
So it's important to keep that under control. If you see sugar syrups forming, just get a pastry brush and some cold water and just brush it down.
That's that simple.
Yeah, yeah. Okay,
right.
So that is going. See, this is so easy.
Ready?
Is it ready?
It's almost done.
Awesome.
Quick. Here we go. Now you can add the lime juice there.
Straight into it?
Into it, yeah. And I imagine the sweet watermelon and the added sugar and that like tartiness of the lime that's in there. It's so beautiful. And it also gives the watermelon an even fresher, like lighter taste. I don't know how to explain it to you.
Okay, while we wait for this, I'd like to play a game with you guys called Would You Rather. It'll be different for every single person. Gürkan, would you rather be on a BMX or a professional bike?
Professional bike.
Okay. Thenjiwe, comedy or politics?
Comedy.
Okay. Bucie? Prenda fasi ole
matosa. Oh, wow!
It's just fitting. It's just fitting.
I have to say Brenda Fassi.
Ah.
Really? Because now you're saying one, so I have to go for...
Okay, yeah, here we go.
All right. And then, Rosie, would it be comedy or a romantic movie?
Romantic movie. I hand it to comedians. It's not easy to be funny, really.
Really?
Yeah, it's not easy being funny. That's a true talent.
I thought you'd go comedy.
I would love to do comedy, but it's the easier route, with respect to the comedian in the house, definitely.
And the people in parliament, because they give us the run for our money.
Yeah, they do.
They do.
To everybody, internet or TV?
TV.
Internet,
yeah.
Why internet as well?
Mm-hmm.
You make your own rules. You work at your own time, you decide what you want to do, when you want to do it, and you reach a lot more people.
Guys, we made TV. People
want...
Are you saying that? We made
reality. But now all people have own media power now. Mm. With Twitter, so Instagram and Facebook, it's give you your own media power.
Yes. Well, we've come a long way. I mean, 2016 is almost finished. I mean, it's almost the end of it. Mm. If South Africa had to be a person to you, how old would they be and what sex would South Africa be?
I think South Africa would be a girl.
South Africa? Mm. A girl, how old?
A girl. 23. Very confused.
Mm. Yeah? To you?
For me, South Africa would be a gay man with two daughters and a son.
What a mess. Yeah. Is that what my country looks like?
I'm also confused between religions. Mm. No, absolutely.
So are we ready?
Rosie? Mm.
Confused between, exactly what you're saying, but confused between religions and probably pre-adolescent, like pimples coming out, like what is going on? Who am I? Is this my body?
Ilse? Mm. What is South Africa to you?
South Africa to me is a sexy bikini model.
Yeah?
Yeah.
How old?
Especially if you come from Cape Town.
Of course.
I mean, what's more sexy than Cape Town?
Beautiful hair, right?
Yeah. No, totally, totally.
New friends.
New friends, but what is it? Is it a male to you? Is it a female? How old is South Africa to you from the side that you've seen it in?
For 2016, you said?
Yes.
Okay.
It's, I don't know. It's a complicated question for me.
It's okay if you think South Africa is a stillborn baby, just say
it's fine. That's okay. You don't have to even come to life. You're right.
Because the last 4 or 6 months I'm cycling is all in South Africa,
yes.
And it's changed my life. So I say to my friends, I can live here.
You can live here?
Yeah.
All right.
Wow. After 60 countries.
Yes. See, everyone falls in love with this country. That's what I'm saying. It's definitely something hot or someone hot.
Yeah.
Can I go ahead and blend
here? Yes, let's do
a little blender. Okay, you're going to just take your stick blender and get this nice and pureed into the syrup.
But also, not everyone has these fancy gadgets. Now, how do you make this when you don't have this at home? Are you there with the spoon as you're trying?
Okay, well, what I would do is, if I have to like get really like creative here, I think I would take a masher and mash the watermelon before the syrup goes in.
Here we go.
And then you take a sieve or something and you press it through with a spoon to get everything through. Mm. It's important to get all the pulp into the sorbet. It's going to give it a nicer texture.
So yes, and so I can no excuse. You can make this at home.
Exactly.
Yeah. It sounds like a jet ski on the ocean.
Then, Khanyi, after this, then you can definitely say, I've been drinking watermelon.
That's right.
It's very nice.
Have you guys ever seen the watermelon that you make the hole in? And you put, like, vodka and stuff in, inside?
Oh, yes.
Where have I been?
I saw that in
Zimbabwe. Oh, that's a good party trick. So now it's all blended.
I got you.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
You take your loaf tin and you just pour it in. Easy as that.
Looks delicious.
Easy as pie.
And you make it look so easy. I'm sure when we go home and try it, it's not going to
look this way.
It's
not going to look this way.
So, of course, I've got a final product here for everyone to taste.
All right. You like the sound of that?
Yes. Okay, let's look at this.
Okay, I'm going to give you... So, also remind me again, so I need to take it in and out of the fridge 4 times.
Yeah, about 3-4 times.
Yes, if I don't have an ice cream maker.
Exactly, yeah, yeah. Okay. And then the thing is, once you've done that and it's been stirred enough, you can just leave it in the freezer and it's fine whenever you want to use it. Take it out 10 to 15 minutes before you
And it won't lose its consistency, obviously.
No, it won't. It's just about that initial consistency that you've got to get right.
All right. Yeah. So the panel of tasters, if there's anything like that.
Nice. Perfect.
Perfect?
Yeah.
Thenjiwe? Bucie? Rosie?
You know what you would like with this?
You know,
a little bit of bubbles,
a little bit of fun,
a little bit of champagne.
Yes, a little bit of fun makes everything right.
It needs like a shot of tequila or something in there. Mm.
But it's delicious.
It's very refreshing. I mean, it's the perfect thing for a hot day.
Mm. So, guys, while we enjoy this and you go to an ad break, remember that you can get all of this on Facebook, The Weekend Edition. Remember to also give us your comments on how you'd make your summer festive and fun on hashtag The Weekend Edition. See you after the break.
Still ahead on The Weekend Edition, Princess of House Music Bucie is in the house to tell us about her new album and her bun in the oven.
Welcome back. You've seen her perform throughout the show. Well, we have her on the round table to discuss her music, her life, her whole career, and just being Bucie. But before we start anything, if you don't know who she is, check out this song and probably it will jog your memory. Here we go. Question of what time of the year it is. It's the festive season. If you can hear music like that and see faces like this on the show, it is time to turn up. Bucie, known as the Princess of House, but we're making it official now. You're the Queen of House. She's been in the game for like 15 years or odd.
Can you say 15? It's 10 years next year,
it's been 15 years, man.
It's been 15 years.
You're trying to knock and come in when you still had blonde hair, Ushai stretch on stage. And I used to be like, who's the... girl coming through like this.
Oh man, in shorts. I can't it's even wear shorts now. But anyway, it's been a journey.
It's part of it. You're still, you've got something
and
in the oven.
I'm like, oh my gosh, look at that arm and look at this one now. But anyway, it's all good. Thank you, baby.
But before we talk to you, that video had two interesting people that are big names today. They call themselves Boys and Bucks. Casper, and you gave Casper his first debut on a video.
I remember even when I asked him, he was so nervous. Like, he calls me Sis Bucie.
Yes.
Sis Bucie, Siraz. And I actually wanted him to play the arrogant, pompous guy.
Yes.
And he was just like, no, I want to play. I'm like, but you're a rapper, you know? And Rappers are known to be those guys. He's like, no, I just want to be, you know, the chilled guy. And I was like, okay, no, cool. You know, since this is about you, this is your video, this is what you want, it's fine, you have that.
Oh, wow.
And the way he just played it for me, it was just like, oh, my word.
He was so adorable.
You know, you're so adorable. You knew exactly what you wanted to do. So it was fun. It was fun. Plus, he was there on time.
Yes.
I was very impressed with him.
So how does a girl from Klerksdorp build a fan base in the States that is so big? I don't know if South Africans know that. You're actually bigger in Europe and in the States. The reason why I say this, I went to Miami with you guys a few years ago, and I always tell you the story because I still can't believe how big you are over there. I got to Miami, and there were over... I don't know how many people were in that club because it was so packed. And they were all there to see Bucie.
Even when I saw them, I remember just seeing you coming to the front like...
Because
I
couldn't believe it.
I'm like, Superman. I'm thinking, hey, that's Khanyi.
No, because I was in the back getting a drink from the bar, I think, at some point. And every person in that place sang your song word for word. I went to the front because I wanted to see everyone. I had to see this.
Is this really, really, really my homegirl? Yeah, man. I don't know. Actually, the first song that gave us our biggest break, especially internationally with Black Coffee, was Turn Me On.
Yes.
Because Turn Me On was actually bigger in Europe than it was even in South Africa.
True.
So then Superman was sort of a follow-up song, which was released 2009. So it just... He played it in Miami. He brought back a video where Louis Vega heard the song and he was in tears. And I personally could not understand because, you know, sometimes you know what God has given you, but you sometimes don't really understand exactly what it is because it's not yours. You are just given, or now you just enjoy the face to go and represent that.
Mm.
So when you see things like that, you don't really take them seriously. You just think, ah, man. And then you get to go to a country where people don't even understand your language.
Yeah.
And they sing along to your music because it's almost as if they understand your soul, they understand the emotion in the song. And it's just like, is this really me? Oh my word. So it's always been like that. It still is.
Your understanding of romance and love is very deep. You write lyrics as if you're writing a novel, but it's a song.
It's a song.
What relationship do you have with love?
I grew up in a very loving family. I'm one of the luckiest people to grow up with a mother and a father. And I just saw how my dad used to love my mom. Uh-huh. You know, she was his queen. May his soul rest in peace. And I always told myself that I need a man that's going to love me exactly the same way that man loves this woman, you know? Yeah. Because love is there. Mm. And then you get to move to Joburg and you get exposed to so many, many things. And you read stories every day about not just people that are in love that kill each other, but men that kill children and
yes, all the that whole family. Yeah,
it's for me, it's just like, oh my God, where is love? Where is this love? So me just singing about it and talking about it, for me, it's in ministry I'm talking about love, because God is love.
Yes.
You know, my mom is a pastor. Everyone expected me to be singing gospel music, but instead I sing about love, which is something that I saw, which is something in Nqwiliso, which is like love. So whether it's talking about relationship or just talking about loving one another, you know, yes. I love you, girl.
Yeah, I know I love you too, babe.
I know.
What I want to know is, I mean, when you perform, for people that have never seen you perform, you literally give us a full show and understanding of what love is.
Of what I'm talking
yes.
about.
Yes, so if it's love making, you make it such a beautiful form
mom
to watch.
My mom is watching, mommy.
That's why. When I heard that you're a child of a pastor, I was like, whoa. How does her mom feel about this? Because she leaves us feeling some type of way
some
every time she...
Yeah. My mom is very sweet. She's an amazing woman.
Yeah.
I always say she's my role model. Like, she gave birth to me. I mean, she raised me. She must be very strong.
Hmm.
But even when I started, you know most how people are going to be like, oh, no, your mom is a pastor, but you're singing. And my mom was just like, you know what? It's your music.
Mm.
It's what you love doing. You were singing Beyonce and Mariah Carey in the house. You're not always singing gospel music.
True.
So as long as I know this is how I raised you and usakhulale njani ndikhule singayo, so it's fine.
Mm.
It's your job. Just go and do it. And just make sure that when you do it, you are the best at it. So my mom gave me, she gave me a heads up, like, thumbs up from the very first song, Billion Dollar.
Yes.
She was just like, you're happy. It's not exactly what you do every day.
Mm.
It's just that one thing that you do for 45 minutes on stage, and then
yes.
you come back and you are the daughter that I raised, so it's fine.
House vocals weren't quite big when you started out in the industry. And if you were a house singer, you had to either be an oversized woman from America. For you get
from America.
For America, because that,
true?
I'm telling you, you had to be oversized. Because I'm a house head, so I understand my house music.
Mm.
You had to be oversized and from America and have a certain tone. But you came in with your own style of singing, which a lot of people are like, no, she pitches too much.
Mm-hmm.
No, her music. How was it breaking into that space and getting the respect?
It wasn't easy, I must say. And I have to say big ups to Black Coffee and Damon, because they're the ones that made sure Gucci people know Gucci, this is a force to be reckoned with.
Yes.
I remember when I went to Portugal this one time, this guy actually said to me, you know, whenever I listen to your music, I've always pictured this big.
Yes.
And here you are so tiny.
Yes.
But your voice is like, what you say in your songs is so big. So for them to be able to make me say what I want to say the way that I want to say it and give me a house beat that is going to go exactly with my voice, it had to be them. I always say it's big ups to them. I don't know how they did it, but me working with them and being close with Black Coffee, no, not the more, and O Christos.
Yes.
You know?
You worked with
like,
plates.
I
yeah.
worked, you know,
yeah.
Rough Gum. Just recently, Louis Vega.
Hey.
I've worked with Louis Vega. And you go to, oh my gosh, like if I have to just go on, the people that I've worked with are the ones that did it for me.
Wow.
Because all I did is just, I just go into studio and I want to sing and I want to say what I want to say. When it comes to beats and everything, the only time I actually had a say in a beat was Easy to Love.
Oh.
That was the first time I actually had
they
a say.
They allowed you to say something.
Yes, because I got a studio and he had two beats and I kept saying, I like this one.
More than that.
More than that one. And he kept saying, but this one, I was like, nah, I want this one.
Yes.
There was just something about this beat. And when I started writing the song, it had to be in isiZulu because most of my songs
English.
Are in English.
Yes.
So I wanted to sing isXhosa and mix it with Zulu.
Mm.
And there was just something. And then I think maybe then I can say, that's when I was like, okay, maybe I can do this on my own.
But you are easy to love. You are. Stop. But I'd like to dare you to do something for me right now. Will you do it for me?
I don't trust you. When you dare me, you're going to dare me to do something crazy.
Try
me. Pregnant, have mercy on me.
I will have mercy. Try me. I dare you to please perform for me right now.
Okay, if you want me to perform for you, then you have to tell me which song. Well, and you mean perform, not just sing, right?
No, perform. Perform, to actually stand up and perform for us.
All right.
No, I want you to see, I want to see if you can read my mind. I'm going to let you perform.
Okay.
Because I think you know what I like.
All right. I do know
All right.
what you like.
She has said yes to my dear, so here's Bucie performing a song that's in my head. Hopefully it's the right one.
The second song that I'm about to do, the title is Rejoice. And this is Khanyi's favorite song. That's exactly the song she was thinking. Hope you enjoy it.
Baby, I like it when you tell the boys I'm with my woman. I'll be with my woman. This life has just begun. We've had our fun. We shed a tear. Kunga konsas bandingo.
She knows me. I told you she knows me. She heard my thoughts and she gave it to me. And I know you enjoyed it. So tell me, how much do you love her music? Hashtag the weekend edition. Don't go anywhere because the show is just getting better and better. See you after the break.
After the break, actress and women's rights activist Rosie Motene chats about her storied career, and Brett Rogers meets up with the Playground SA team, designers who create affordable furniture.
Welcome back. Thank you for hanging out with us today. So Rosie is known as an actress, an activist, a casting agent now, and a woman who's changed the face of South African TV from generations to many other programs. Welcome to the show.
Thank you very much. It's very exciting.
So exciting, but you've become African. You're a global citizen now.
Pan-African, you're no longer... baby.
Yeah.
Yeah.
When did this happen?
I had the wonderful opportunity of working for Studio 53 with...
Yes.
Where we toured the continent, told stories about food, tradition, culture. And with that, I was a studio presenter, I was a field reporter, then trained as a director and producer for the show, and saw the continent and fell in love. Realised how sexy our continent is.
Is Africa sexy?
Oh, it is, baby. It is.
Your favourite countries?
Oh, okay, definitely Uganda,
yes.
which I'm based there now. Nigeria's got an amazing energy. It's the same with Ghana. Ghana's more regal. You know, but there isn't one country, you know, even with the incidents that have happened in like certain countries, there isn't one country that I think, well, I never want to go back there again. Especially East Africa, you've always greeted with this warm welcome. People are genuine. The food is delicious. And, well, the chocolate men are also delicious.
Trust me, we are all about that. Trust and believe. But what was your move? I mean, yes, you did Studio 53. For anyone who doesn't know what that is, it's like the Toppling of Africa. They do exactly what Toppling does and even bigger.
Yeah.
But what made you leave South Africa and really venture into Africa?
You know, for the last 10 years, I've been visiting Uganda. I started off, I was the face of Uganda Fashion Week in 2006.
I remember, yes.
Yeah. And, you know, every time I went back, there's just a lot of opportunities that are happening there. You know, I believe that where East Africa is sitting at the moment, Ghana and Nigeria were sitting there about 7 or 8 years ago. So they're about to explode into this media explosion. Everyone's got the expertise, they've got the techniques, they want to create their own stories. And for me to be part of that rive and to accomplish my Pan-African dream, I needed to be on the continent. And I love South Africa. I always love South Africa. I will always carry that passport. I'm very, very proud of that. But I just think that there's just so much to explore north of the Limpopo. And that is my journey for the next couple of years.
Well, I must commend you, because South Africans, I feel that we're so comfortable in our own country that it's rare to always find a South African who's willing to leave their home to get something else, because we believe we have it all here. Why must I go anywhere?
And the thing is, there's a lot of challenges, you know what I mean? So you, from the infrastructure, from the transport, you know, from the food. But one piece of advice that I would give to any South African is just go with an open heart and go with an open mind, because I promise you, you're going to be received well.
Wow.
Yeah.
As an actress, personally, I know... my life depends on making my viewer, my fan, happy. But you've always gone against the grain. You've never tried to fit in. So if a weave is the hardest thing, you'd never run and do a weave. You're always questioning things.
Yeah.
Why must I be in a weave? Why must I be fleek? Why must I have brows? Why? What makes you comfortable in your own skin and say, look, if you don't like it, but I like it, this is who I am?
You know, I think it has a lot to do with the fact that I grew up in an unconventional manner. So growing up from an early age, I was always the odd one out. I was always discriminated. So whether it was my accent, whether it's I'm hanging with white people, whether it's I hated being black as a kid.
Yes, of course.
So that's a major identity crisis. So I think with all of that, and that when you get to a point in your life and you think, well, I need change and I'm going to do it for me. You know, the first time I shaved my head, I did it for a friend who had cancer.
Yes.
So that was a gift to her. And then it just, I was like, I'm going to grow hair again. What? It costs what to shave compared to the weave that I was paying for? You know what I mean? And so you just it's about exploring life, and it's about putting yourself in the positions and the places where the universe has put you.
But how do you feel of the industry now? I mean, it's turned out to become, especially on TV, use the popular face on social media to get the numbers.
Yeah.
Do you agree with this, making TV a popular portal to make people famous?
You know what? Yes and no. It's very, very scary, because you're taking away positions and jobs from people who really work for that talent, you know? So if you're talented and you have that following, by all means, then you need to be pushed into certain spheres. Yeah. But a lot of cases, it's not just happening in South Africa, it's happening around the world, is that, okay, well, we're just going to go for this person because she's the it girl and we like it. Meantime, that person doesn't have one ounce of talent, and then you've got somebody down the road who's been studying all these years, got all these degrees, and is sitting at home with this talent. So it's a bit of a catch and throw situation. So there's that situation, and then also the fact that a lot of this is thrown on our young people very, very early.
Hey.
Not ready mentally.
Yeah.
It can have a lot of detrimental effects.
I think
effects.
I'm an example of the young people that actually got this too soon.
And you're a strong person. We weren't worried about you. We knew that, you know, Khanyi's going to get out of this. Yeah, she's going to go and... I mean, you had everything thrown at you. And we thought, no, Khanyi. But there are those girls who are not going to be able to walk out of their house. Mm. There are those girls who are not going to be able to lift up their heads. And we might resort to other means and measures. As we know, the industry itself is ridden with drugs and alcohol. So there's that avenue.
Mm.
So, you know, if you can nurture the young girls and young boys from an earlier age, it's about standing your ground, knowing where you stand, but also believe in yourself as a brand. You're a business.
Yes.
And a business, getting somewhere fly by night, remember, tomorrow can be taken away from you at any point in time.
Trust.
Any point in
time.
Trust. Yeah.
They always say that an activist is a mad black woman or a woman that is bitter.
Yeah.
You've become that. Why are you an activist? Are you bitter? Are you mad
bitter,
and angry?
I love life. I'm happy. I can scream and shout. I can scream for joy.
Yeah.
But I also believe in using my voice. And that's when I became an activist, because I realised, I mean, my abuse situation happened when I was in university, and I didn't really deal with it.
Yeah.
And then when I was in a position to use my voice, and when I did, and it was at a very small event, it was at a women's group in East London, people came to me and were like, no, I relate. And I was like, whoa. That's when I realised that
I related. You know, you saved me in my situation as well.
You know, and so that for me, and when people say, well, you know, your activism, it's for me, it's a way of life now. You know, and I will stand up for it. And there's, you know, some people are like, oh, shit, Rosie's in the house. We can't say this, whatever. I was like, yeah, you can't. Why are you going to joke about that? Why is rape supposed to be a joke around the table?
Yes,
it isn't.
Yeah.
You know what's happening to our children, and it's also happening to men. We need to adhere to what's been going around and take action.
You're a different black person. Judaism, like, what is that? How do you evens, like,
you know,
what is that?
Well, I was brought up in a Jewish home, and my foster family were Jewish. Are Jewish, rather.
Yes.
And I decided to convert much later in life, because I wanted to convert when I was 100% sure this is the journey that I wanted to go on.
Mm-hmm.
And also, I want to have children, and my children will be Jewish. So that was my journey. It was a tough journey, because people think, well, you don't wake up one day, so I'm going to become Jewish.
Of course.
It's a two-year learning.
Yes.
It's Hebrew.
You need to be serious.
Yeah,
about
and you've got to want to do it. You've got to be passionate about it. And that's something that also resonates with me. And I think that's why I also love Uganda, because there's a very, very rich black Jewish community that are based in Uganda, which I visit them regularly. When I was on a Jewish radio station here, the rabbi interviewed him. So there's that, also that strong spiritual connection that I have there. And, you know, we are the chosen people, so...
Say it. I'm Rosie and I'm different.
Yeah.
You are different. Well, speaking of different things, there's a young group of men that have started to make furniture, and they call it Playground SA. They've come together as a group to try and change their situation and make it into a profitable one. Let's check out what they do, and they call themselves Ubuntu.
When starting a business, something seemingly mundane like furniture can be a source of frustration. By pushing design culture, Playground SA is creating solutions for businesses that need innovative furniture and display units. Brunello, can you tell me where we are and what Playground SA is?
Okay, cool. Right now we're at the RHTC Playground pop-up store, and it's a collaboration between these two brands that distributes local streetwear only. So everything you see here, products that are locally owned and locally produced as well. Playground provides the furniture, so that's the furniture company, and that too caters for modern entrepreneurs. These are entrepreneurs that don't want to be confined to one space at a scheduled time, but want to pop up wherever they wish to.
So I'm extremely interested in your ethos for Playground SA. What is that ethos and what does it mean?
The ethos for Playground SA is democratizing premium capability. And what that means is that there are a lot of entrepreneurs that have potential but cannot actively participate, and we give them furniture to do so.
So you're the businessman behind this all. Who's the person who's doing all this designing?
There's the business, which I handle. There's the design, which is handled by Sandy Limshong. We call him Sansa. Then the production is handled by a guy called Computer. Real name's Lucy Sinclair.
Sansa, this Sansa. Sansa. I'm sorry, right. Sansa. So Sansa, you're the designer. What is your philosophy of design with Playground SA?
So basically at Playground SA, we have three design pillars. It needs to be premium and affordable. It needs to be mobile friendly, and it needs to be multifunctional.
Based on these design pillars, the company cleverly creates units which are aesthetically pleasing and can easily be adapted for small spaces, markets, and trade events. All right, Sansa, so we're looking at a bunch of ingredients here. Tell me what you're looking at.
We are looking at the one pillar stall, and it also turns into a table. You can use its element to sort of like carry it around, and you can use the stall itself to store all the elements within it.
We went from a bunch of wood with no pliers, no screws, no tools, and we have a table in a couple of seconds.
Exactly, and you can sort of like use the shelves that you'd normally use on the store as a shelf for your table. You can put books there, you can store, like, you can even put your tea there while you're drinking.
You can even put your tea there. So many uses. What's behind the name Playground?
The name itself, a playground is a place that invites everyone to play, and we make furniture that invites everyone to sort of like come play with us. Because personally, I feel like our furniture, it's like big puzzles that you get to put together and have fun while doing it.
All right, that took 2 minutes to make. Let's see the one pillar stall.
Okay, cool.
Bye. So, I mean, when you're looking at this, you don't have to look at it as a professional thing, right? People can buy this for their home or for their business. It's not necessarily just a one functional professional item.
Exactly, because like when you look at it this way, it's like an open closet. And it literally opens like room for you to actually show off your clothing. It's like, yo man, this is my outfit for the day.
And it's all South African. Every single thing you have here is South African, right?
Yeah, every single thing, right down to the shoes. So I feel like this is the one store that you can come to get a South African outfit from head to toe.
But now, luckily, as I walked into the store, there's a gentleman here who actually uses their products. So we're gonna meet him next. The company is passionate about working with entrepreneurs and startup businesses who need to be able to showcase their products with swag while sticking to a tight budget. All right, Weekenders, we have found Lindelani from Swank. Lindelani.
Hi.
Hey, man. Tell me about Swank, and tell me why you use Playground SA for your design.
Hey, cool. So Swank is an urban streetwear brand. So we've been hooking up and working with the Playground SA for this year, and they've been helping a lot because they kind of like help us as a young business with the furniture. So when you go to like pop-ups and markets, we can actually use the furniture to display our product, and it gives it that premium look.
And what about for your own specific needs? Have the guys been able to customize products for you?
Yes, the guys have been able to kind of like customize the products for us, because we come to them with like a specific idea and an approach. We want to present our stuff and like the specific collection, and they kind of like sit down with us and they explain and kind of like give us an alternative on what kind of store we can create and we can use for the display, yeah, and setup.
With simple plywood, dowel rods, copper piping, and truly inspired design, this business is helping others on the road to success and growing the reach of local entrepreneurs. Democratizing premium capability. Think about those three words, they're so important. Those three words will build our country. So, buy local.
After today's show, you cannot come back and say, I blame my life because I can't do anything. You use every situation in your life and make it work for you. These guys have done it, you do it too. Hashtag The Weekend Edition, we're still going at it, so you want to come back after the break. See you now.
Still to come, Rosie Motene opens up about her activism for women's rights, and Brett Rogers joins roller derby enthusiasts for a day of skating fun in Joburg.
Welcome back. No boys allowed. Why? Because girls run the world, and that's why I put them on the round table. Just to put some order and life into this weekend. I'm kidding. Guys, I invited you to the table to talk about what's happening now. 16 days of activism. And that's your moment. This is like your time to shine, because yeah, you live for this stuff. Mm-hmm. What does it mean to you?
You know, it's changed over the years, mm-hmm, because as much as I believe and I live by creating awareness on an everyday basis, the 16 days of activism, Women's Day, and certain events like that, people just think that you just need to be vigilant and aware during that period, mm-hmm, and it's not. Mm-hmm. You know, violence has affected communities across the world.
True.
And people have died. Mm. People are still dying. People are still in bondage. People are still suffering. So we need to create this awareness, but don't corporates stop riding on the fact, okay, well, it's 16 days of activism, let's have a tea party because that's what it's about. No,
true.
It's a lot deeper than that. Mm. And we need to acknowledge it and, as I said, take it into our every single day lives. It needs to be 365 days of awareness.
So, Thenji, are you against polygamy?
No, I'm not against it, as long as women are also allowed to marry as many men as they want to, without being judged and being called names. Mm. And then also, as long as it's people of a legal age, not when it's young children, that's not polygamy, that's abuse, that's rape. Is. And, yeah, but if you are of a legal age, you're making an informed choice and you're not doing it because of poverty, just because the man has money and is going to be able to buy you food or give you a better place to live, then that's fine. Because the problem we have is people will say, I'll marry into polygamy. Will you marry Jablani who works in a garage station? No. It's about
love. He's not going to feed us.
Exactly.
Jablani's not going to feed us.
Exactly.
You can't. But we see, I mean, women look up to you as an artist, and always musicians are the beacon of being, you know, examples in society, even though you don't do it yourself, but you become a role model. What does the 16 days mean to you?
For me, I concentrate more on the emotional abuse, because on 16 days they always concentrate on
physical
you know, violence, and there's emotional abuse. That now you are abused as a child and you grow up with that thing, even when you're older and you're a woman, you still don't value yourself because that's what you were taught when you were young.
Sure.
That you are worthless, that you will be nothing, or you need a man to be able to do whatever you want to do in life and all of that. So I'll say, as someone they look up to, I always just tell them that, listen, you are powerful.
Mm.
When God created you and made you a woman, He knew exactly what He was doing, so never doubt that. So if we can just, as much as we concentrate on that, concentrate on the emotional as well. Obuti, they need to grow up knowing their worth and their value. Because now, if you know your worth and your value, when a man starts putting his hands on you, you walk away. You tell yourself that, I might not have food, I might not have anything, but I'm not going to be your punching bag.
True, true.
And it's so important because, you know, we focus on, as you said, we focus on the physical, but if you're teaching our young girls at an earlier age, and even with my abusive situation, and it was no fault of my parents, they only taught me about the physical. But if I'd started seeing the signs when he was telling me that I'm fat and I'm stupid and I would never graduate, I could have walked away much sooner. I was lucky I got out. I just got smacked. But I could have walked away a long time before. And I think that's an incredibly important message too.
But we always applaud women that walk away, and we also forget that there's something called battered woman syndrome. Where do they fall in the 16 days? Because do they have help? Because a battered woman, it literally takes them about 12 years to get themselves back. Or they'll never get that piece of them back ever again. And I speak for them because I was that. I am that. I'm a battered woman. And there are certain things in your life that you'll never, ever be able to do openly and freely, because you're closed, you know, you're closed in. Are there programs to help women like that?
Yes, there are lots of programs. I mean, there's Power, there's a lot of women's organizations, there's a lot of children's organizations, and they can do so much, but it's also about the will of the person. How far down the line are they? How, you know, some people might need years of therapy. It all varies per person and per situation. And that's why it's so important to create awareness now, because we've got young boys and girls who are being born every single day.
True.
And so from an early age, they need to know that they're on the same level platform. You know, if you look, there's been an increase in bullying from young boys. Why? Because young boys feel that, okay, with the rising of a girl child and so forth, which is important, but these young boys don't know where they fit in society.
True.
So while we're focusing on the girls, remember, a young boy also needs to know his place next to a woman. And it's not going to be through this, it's about this and it's about here.
Yes. Right. But look,
I would like is to have 16 days of payback time, where we bring all the abusers, take all the battered women to pay back.
Hey,
just be allowed for 16 days.
Okay. Do I get to choose the guy that I want to really give back to with?
Anyone who's ever abused you, or anyone who's ever abused any
woman. The guy.
Yeah. And you can buy a guy to go and beat them up for you.
Well. I'd like to set out a disclaimer that all the views that are set at this table are not of the channel, the show, or the production company, but of the guests. So don't be writing to the BCCSA and say, ha, 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 they're promoting violence. It's got nothing to do with the SABC or the channel, but ourselves, but, honestly.
Guess, sorry to cut you off, but the one thing that I think along the years that I've noticed when it comes to women who've been abused is that it takes time for them to forgive themselves. Mm-hmm. If you can work on forgiving yourself. Yes. Because when you get abused, it is not your fault. Mm-hmm. You are not the problem. Do you understand? Mm-hmm. So, like, now, because you believe that you're the problem, you tend to build the walls around you. Mm-hmm. And you just think, okay, now, since I'm the problem, now I need to protect everyone. Mm-hmm. From me,
true, do you understand?
And it like really, like I'm saying, it has nothing to do with you. It's the person that you are with that saw the need to put you down so that they can feel better. Mm. So now you are taking that, and now you need to forgive yourself, Uguti. You know what? I forgive myself for even looking at myself like that, in that way, in that light. When actually the person that was wrong is the one that was doing that to me, and still at the same time. I can't say abuse, man. You have an excuse to say, no, I was abused because I did 1, 2, 3, and 4. No, it's wrong, period. Mm-hmm. So forgive yourself for even allowing yourself to go through that. Mm-hmm. And when you do, life. Wow. Mm.
But for every disadvantage, there's always an advantage. Mm. Always. What is the advantage of being a woman in 2016? There must be perks, guys. I mean, the government's trying so hard to get women involved in a lot of things. Mm. We get better options in terms of asking for work and applying for certain job positions. What are the perks of being a woman? We need to brag a bit and let the guys understand that it is our time.
We get to carry the children.
Hey!
Yeah. Feel the kids.
We've been doing that for years, girl.
You know?
We've been doing it for years. That's one of the perks.
But I think for me, it's that wonderful knowledge that I can do. I've done everything on my own. Mm. And yes, there's going to be a point where I want to share it with somebody. But, you know, I've traveled the world on my own. Mm. I've changed my tire on my own. I can do stuff, you know what I mean? And it's not about relying on that next person. And being okay, being alone is another thing. People are like, well, how do you go on holiday on your own? Easy. You get online, you book a ticket, and you go.
Yes.
And you have fun.
And you can ask the waiter and strangers to take your pictures. Yes. Simple. Mm-hmm. Yeah. No. For you, Tench?
I think it's we live in the times where you don't need a man. Mm. It's nice to have someone, but you don't need a man. Like when you look back into our history, where women were not even allowed to open a bank account unless they had a man. Where women, you can be you. You can even raise children by yourself.
Of course.
And successful children.
Mm. Yes, yes.
So we no longer need a man to validate us. Yeah. You can run a business. Mm. You can be successful on your own. Mm. And as sisters, we can... We're no longer in a space where we're always competing. Mm. We can be women and work together. Yes. And this is a beautiful space for us.
Lovely.
Mm. I was actually going to say what she just said, Ugutim. The perks of being a woman in 2016, especially in South Africa, is the fact that you can actually use your brain and you can study and work and be a female artist that is in a male-dominated industry, and you are killing it.
Mm. And you can do it as a woman, being as feminine. It's not about putting that power suit on.
Yes.
You can be sexy and finding out that power in our
that
feminine.
Mm-hmm. That. That's all.
Yeah. Wow.
Or which you can do it, honey. Ufike Pyanaje, and it's just you. And, you know, because I still know that there are countries where you are not allowed to be given that opportunity and that power to, like, just be yourself as a woman. Wow. You just need to always shala under the carpet, please. We don't need to see your boobs.
Wow, guys, thank you so much. All of your views make so much sense. But here's another group of women that are really showing that why it's so important and good to be a woman in 2016. These women put on rollerblades, they race around a track, and they're dressed in the most sexiest way, playing with things that men do, the toughest girls in Johannesburg. Brett got to hang out with them and see what's happening in this thing called Roller Derby Gathering. Let's check it out.
Speeding around a track on old-school quad roller skates while being body slammed and blocked is tough stuff. But the women who love the action of roller derby are showing their strength and girl power.
Here at the Weekend Edition, we pride ourselves in finding you the best, most interesting hidden gems, and today's no different.
We're at the Portuguese Recreation Center in the south of Joburg, and there is interesting stuff happening out there. There's passion, there's power, and not from where you expect.
Roller derby is the fastest growing women's sport in the world. The CMAX Roller Derby League in Johannesburg was established in 2010. It was the first roller derby league on the continent.
Amy, you're looking pretty badass.
Thanks.
Thanks. Is that what you're going for? Is that
yeah,
why
you, totally.
Is that why you're wearing the pad here, just to look
yeah,
badass?
Yeah, just to look badass. No,
they're not just for show. We really, really need the gear. We can't skate without it. We're not allowed to skate without it, but we definitely wouldn't. Obviously, our helmets protect us from getting a concussion.
Oh, great. Concussions.
Yeah. There's a lot of falling. There's a lot of knee sliding. So everything's sort of generally on the front. That's where we tend to go over more.
What is the ethos of roller derby? Why do you have it? What is it about?
Why do we have it? I think it's just really about time that women have a sport that they've created, that's about them, that's created by them, that's run by them. Like, we run everything. There is men's roller derby as well, but this is first and foremost a women's sport, where most sports are first and foremost men's sports.
How does the game actually work, Amy?
Okay, so I'm gonna try and break it down really, really quickly. Usually our games are an hour long. They're made up of two half an hour halves with a 15 minute break in between. Each half an hour is split up into 2 minute jams, okay? So you have four blockers from each team, and one jammer from each team on the track. The whistle goes, the jammers have got to break through the pack of blockers. The first one out is the lead jammer, and they can each score points off of every person they pass.
The fast pace and full body contact action makes the sport fun to watch, but like any other sport, nobody is allowed to play dirty. There are plenty of rules which can get a player sin-binned by one of the referees.
Alex, the Zebracorns. Who are the Zebracorns and who are you?
The Zebracorns is the official ref team for CMAX Roller Derby in Johannesburg. I am currently today playing as the head ref for the Zebracorns. I'm basically in charge of every game that goes down today.
What is it about roller derby that you enjoy so much?
It doesn't matter if you've played a sport before in your life or not. It's open to anybody. Anybody can really come and give it a try. Some people excel, some people don't. But you do what you want to do, you do what you can do, and where you feel comfortable. It's an accepting community where everybody's welcome.
Suki Smackhouse, if that is your real name.
It's my derby name, does that count?
It counts.
It counts on track. It counts if you're all on track.
So when I'm watching the sport, I'm seeing gum guards flying and umpires going, picking it up. There must be some really real injuries. Have you had any while you've been playing?
I've been quite lucky. I haven't had any really big ones. We've had we've had two or three broken ankles. I've only dislocated my ribs, so I haven't had like a major break. And I broke my nose a little bit once, but not like, doesn't, like, still pretty straight. But I mean, we've had less and less injuries since we've been doing a lot more physical training. So like, for example, one of our coaches, he does CrossFit with us. And since the stronger we get and the more conditioned by playing more, and the more you play, the more conditioned you get less injuries overall.
The sport really seems to be growing. Have you seen many changes over your time while you've been doing roller derby?
Definitely. I think we've become a lot more athletic, a lot more professional, especially since the World Cup. We played in 2014. We played in the World Cup in Dallas, Texas. I mean, even if you look at us, if you looked at us 6 years ago, we were still fishnets, booty shorts. You know, it was more for the entertainment value as well as trying to grow our sports. But since that time, and I mean, next year's the World Cup as well, it's definitely growing. And I think the only thing that's holding us back in particular is like a struggle to find sponsorship. We put the time and we put the work in, but being recognized as a serious sport, I think, is one of the challenges we're trying to overcome to get sponsors to recognize. Because the more support we have, the more we can grow. Like, it's the World Cup next year.
Women aged 18 years and older are welcome to try roller derby. Teams in Cape Town, Pretoria, Durban and Josie. Or gather your friends and be supporters at a local derby for a fun sports experience.
Well, weekenders, I've had a smashing day watching these smashing women do their own kind of smashing. So if you've had a rough 2016, perhaps roller derby is the answer to your frustrations.
So there you have it. Women are doing it for themselves. So bring your boys, because my girls are just as strong. Hashtag the weekend edition. Are you enjoying the show? Because I'm enjoying your company. See you now.
Coming up, finishing up her stone fruit inspired desserts, Chef Ilse Fourie makes a tantalizing mango yogurt parfait. It's a weekend, yeah.
It's a weekend, yeah. So all things come in threes. This is our last and final dish. Three dishes to make it incredible. Hope you're still enjoying the show. So what are we making now? And that's very hot.
Yeah, just stay away there.
It's not good for my hair.
Okay, so we're making a mango yogurt parfait with grilled pineapple. So for those of you who don't know, parfait is basically like frozen layer dessert. I'm doing that today, but I'm going to be doing it all combined into one loaf, except to be layered. So a parfait in general will consist of fruit, sugar, syrup, eggs, and here we have all our components. So I'm going to start off with our mascarpone and our cream, which need to be whisked into soft peaks. So I'm going to give each person here a job so we can get this done quickly.
Yeah.
It's quite a...
Okay. So we want to eat it quickly.
Okay, so I'm going to put this over there. So just combine those two, and I'm going to give you a whisk and just whisk it until you get soft peaks. Okay. Our next component is our mango pulp, which was made with fresh mangoes. And it was pressed through a sieve. And we basically got this here with some Greek-style yogurt. Okay, so these two are going to be combined.
Okay.
And once you're done with that, you can pop it back into the freezer until you make your next component, okay. Which is perfect.
So just mix this in together.
Just mix those two together.
Okay. There you go. Perfecto.
Okay. And then what we have here is egg yolks and sugar syrup. So remember we made that sugar syrup earlier. Mm. So it's exactly the same thing.
With the lemon.
Not with the lemon. Okay. Just the normal sugar syrup with your sugar and your water. And while it's warm and it came off the your...
What do you call this
pan? Should we turn this down?
Yeah, because it's... There we are.
So while the sugar syrup is hot, you will use a blend, not a blender, a mixer.
A mixer.
You'll use a mixer and you'll combine, you'll mix the eggs until it's nice and light in color.
Is it the egg yolk or is it?
The egg yolks.
The egg yolk.
Egg yolks.
Okay.
And then you'll add your sugar syrup and you'll combine the two and continue mixing it until it cools down.
Yeah.
It takes about 4 to 5 minutes. Okay. And then you have this beautiful, creamy, textured egg yolk and syrup mix.
Yes.
Okay, so these are all going to be combined together, and then we're going to grill some pineapples to eat with this parfait.
What do you call this pan? It looks fancy.
It's a griddle pan. I quite like it because it gives beautiful marks on, on the food.
Makes it look gourmet.
Yeah. So we're going to take our pineapples, put some sugar on for some extra caramelization, and you pop it on there. And we still got some flames there. Sugar. There you go. I don't know if you want to continue with that, and then I'll mix these two in.
So if I wanted spice, because I usually have like pineapple with like a chili spice on
it. Oh, a little bit of cayenne pepper is not going to do anyone any harm.
Nice.
I promise you that. Okay,
nice.
So you, as you, these already.
Okay.
So now I'm going to take my egg yolks and my sugar syrup mix that I've got here, and I'm going to take this and fold it in.
Okay.
So just slowly fold it in your figure of eight. Okay, and then goes my cream mixture. How are we doing over there? Should I give it a little bit of extra arm in here? And then we'll fold this in. So the cream only has to be soft peaks. So don't overdo it. And then once you have your combined mixture here, you take a loaf tin, you layer up with a piece of plastic at the bottom, and then you pour your mixture in, and you cover it and refrigerate it. And this will set about 3 to 4 hours, and it will set and be beautiful like this.
Like that over there.
It's actually in the freezer, not in the fridge.
Okay.
Yeah. So it's almost like an ice cream loaf. That comes out like that.
So should I turn this over?
Yeah, you can turn it over.
The pineapple.
We can turn the heat up here, I think. We need some nice marks on it. Before we turn it over, I'm just going to put this down here.
So you want it dark?
Yeah, get some sugar before you turn it over. Get some sugar on that side as well.
Okay.
Some sugar for my sugar. Okay, so I'm going to plate this so long. So you've got your beautiful loaf here. And it's got the same texture as ice cream, if you feel it. I mean, you think about it, ice cream technically is cream and eggs. So it's kind of similar with fruit added to it. And then to make it look really pretty for your guests, we're going to add some limes to your board. And some lime zest. I think you have a cheese craving.
Does it remind you of cheese?
It's yellow, man. It looks like cheese to me.
And then I'm going to add some mint.
Cheese, girl.
Oh, I love mint.
That one's not so good.
Love me some mint.
Also, I think... Wait.
How are we doing there?
How's that?
That looks good. Okay. That looks good.
So you don't want it black.
You're
you
natural.
Just want it...
Yeah, really? Yeah, no, as long as you can see the caramelization happening, it's all good, yeah. Because that's what's going to give that beautiful flavor to that pineapple.
Ah, the pineapple smells.
That caramelization. How are we doing over there? Yeah. That looks good.
But what I like about this
is it's
meals and dishes that you could actually do with your friends instead of leaving people in the lounge.
Yeah.
And you could prepare it together while you chat. And that's what December is about. It's about conversation and having your loved ones with you all the time. How's that?
They're looking good. Yeah, see, you're getting the color change, so you know it's caramelizing with the sugar.
Mm.
And the nice thing is, I mean, as a special touch, you could hoi this in the braai as well when you're having a braai. Add some smokiness to it. And there we go.
Beautiful.
Are we going to dish up?
Absolutely.
Ready for round three.
All right, so while you guys are getting ready with that, you know, in the weekend edition, we always judge and check out what you are wearing. Help me. Let me see what you're wearing this weekend. Send us a picture on hello@theweekendedition.tv. And who knows, we could put it on our social media pages and make you trend. See you after the break.
Still ahead on the Weekend Edition, would you like to try the recipes from our stone fruit desserts menu today? Catch all the recipe details after the break, and Ard Matthews gives us another exclusive performance. It's a weekend, yeah.
It's a weekend, yeah. Welcome back. So you heard him, he spoke about love and how he writes for love and he believes in love while he's standing by to give you his final performance. But before that, your favorite dish.
The sorbet.
The sorbet.
The first one.
The first one.
Definitely the first one.
Yeah.
The strawberry and
I'm not gonna ask you.
It's difficult for me.
Yeah, of course not. But if you've missed any of the dishes, worry not because we have the recap for you. Check it out.
Our theme in the kitchen today is inspired by summer fruits. Our menu consists of a trio of desserts, a yummy strawberry and peach galette, a watermelon and lime sorbet, and a delicious mango yogurt parfait with grilled pineapple. For the galette, make the filling by mixing the strawberries and peaches together with sugar and vanilla. Set aside and allow to soak while you make the crust. To make the crust, whisk flour, sugar and salt. Cut in butter until it resembles a rough crumb. Add water and knead to form dough. Wrap in plastic and refrigerate. Line a baking sheet with baking paper and roll out dough into a circle. Spoon fruit into the center of the dough, leaving a 2 to 3 centimeter gap on the edges. Fold the dough over the fruit, brush with egg wash and bake until golden. For the sorbet, quarter the watermelon, remove the rind and chop into squares. In a saucepan, add sugar, water and lime juice. Heat until the sugar dissolves. Add the water and syrup into a blender and blend until smooth. Strain the mixture, place into a loaf tin and freeze. Scoop and serve. For the parfait, process the mango and strain. Add the yogurt and whisk to combine. Set aside. Whisk cream and mascarpone in a bowl to soft peaks and refrigerate until required. Make a simple syrup and cool to room temperature. Fold into the cream mixture. Spoon into a loaf tin lined with plastic wrap. Freeze until firm. Serve with grilled pineapple tossed in mint and lime. For the full recipes, visit the Weekend Edition on Facebook or log on to our website, www.weekendedition.co.za.
As promised, Mr. Matthews is standing by to give you his last and final performance of the show. So here you go. Enjoy.
Hey, my name is Ard Matthews, and this is a song called Stay Together.
When I pulled myself up from the rubble, you
warmer. Soon enough, I'll make you understand. Oh my, and our loving, baby. We should spend some time on our own. Stay together now, baby. Stay together now. I can see the urgency. We can make this a life on our own. Stay together now. Stay together. I can bring my loving, baby. You can bring a slice of your own. Could enough just be enough? Fill my head and now I'm older. All of my love that you know that I try. Oh, my darling, I. You can make my corner warmer. Soon enough, I'll make you understand. Oh, my. And our loving, baby. Well, we should spend some time on our own. Stay together now, baby. Stay together now. I can see the urgency. We can make this life on our own. Stay together now, baby. Stay together. I can bring my loving, baby. You can bring a slice of your own. Save it for the both of us. We can make it warmer, my lover. You should stay another while. Save it for the both of us. We can change our worlds forever. If our love holds on now. Oh my. Stay together now, baby. Stay together. I can see the urgency. We can make this life on our own. Stay together now, baby. Stay together. I can bring my loving, baby. You can bring a slice of your own. Stay together now, baby. Stay together. I can see the urgency. We can make this life on our own. Stay together now, baby. Stay together. I can bring my loving, baby. You can bring a slice of your own.
Wow. What a day to celebrate Human Rights Day. The question to you, hashtag The Weekend Edition, what is your basic human right according to you? It doesn't even have to be in the Constitution. According to you, what is your basic human right?
My basic human right?
Yes.
I think it's to be an individual and be who you are and express exactly how you are as a person without people judging you.
Mm. I agree.
Yeah.
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 Do you believing in your power? Yeah. Mm. Stage.
Right to make fun of anyone regardless of their social power.
Show me the funny. Economics.
Yeah, what she said, like spot on, where you can just be yourself and not worry about anyone judging you.
Yes.
Or not even being what people expect you to be and just be yourself.
Mm. Wow. Mm. Well, I think the right that we all should have is the art and skill of being wealthy, whether it is through money or through mental capability. Wealth is health, and that's the basic right that we all deserve. Thank you so much for joining us once again and all of the time. See you tomorrow. Wonderful Sunday and a wonderful Saturday to you right now. You at home.